It's kind of been in our DNA since birth, but it has really taken power on this journey, working very closely also with a lot of with the government also and a lot of the cities around Denmark. And there are several examples. One of them that I could pull forward was actually the district energy or the district heating example, that it actually meant that there was a very close cooperation between cities and governments and companies to make sure that we had a very significant district energy or district heating network built. Today, more than 60% of all energy or heat in the country is being distributed by central heating or district heating networks. That is by far the most efficient way of doing that. And there's a lot of technology that has been built over time by doing projects, optimizing them, getting better, bringing new technology into that. And that's where we have played a good role in that. And that means that we've been able to do this in the district heating part much more efficient. It also means that before we used to have power plants making electricity, operating at 30 or 40% efficiency. Now we've added combined heat and power, so we've added the heat, the district heating network to those power stations, and we've raised the energy efficiency from 30 to 40 to above 80%, sometimes close to 90%. All that extra energy has kind of been for free. There's no extra CO2 emission, there's no extra coal or oil or gas or anything that needs to be fired to use that energy. So that's been, I think, very, very, very efficient.
We have an ambition of being a large company in China, and in order to do that, you need to offer something that Chinese people like and want to have. And in our case, it is we very much have good solutions which has been developed for Denmark, but which can be offered to China for a reduction of CO2 and a saving of energy.
If you just hang on to the district energy or district heating example for a while, then I think that's a technology that fits very, very well to where China is going. With a lot of cities, a lot of big cities that are actually now, given the urbanization, getting bigger and bigger, and the forward-looking, I think, planning that is very strong in China. It's actually possible, not as we did it in Denmark, to take old cities and take up the roads and put down pipes, which was quite difficult and quite costly in the beginning. In China, you have the chance to think about this from the beginning and to plan it out. So whenever a new city is being built, it should be built on the best infrastructure that we know of, the most efficient way. So whatever comes next will benefit from the efficiency of the infrastructure. And that infrastructure could be a very efficient, up-to-date grid of district energy. So whoever comes there and builds their house can just tap into the system and can get the energy. And whatever means of energy that will be there in the future, be that solar-based or geothermal or waste incineration or whatever type of energy, can actually just be put onto those networks. So it's kind of a future-safe system that allows to also benefit for whatever technological progress we're going to do in the years to come also. So that's one very good example, I think, of thinking ahead and providing for a high standard of living at very low energy consumption and low CO2 footprint.
So the production equipment that we have for the production of this valve is very modern. It's from 2008 or later, and it is the most modern production facility that we have in the world, actually, of a similar product. So the entire equipment is controlled by vision equipment and, as you can see, by robots.
Well, you see, CSR is good for three parties. It's good for your customers, it's good for your employees, and it's good for the shareholders. So, and the way we do it, of course, is to have a good system of support activities like we do in this city here. Of course, it doesn't give you benefit tomorrow. It's something that takes many years, but if you are famous for doing, supporting the area, you know, schools or some activities in the community, then you get this goodwill in the people. But also with your employees, you have days with sunshine, or you have rainy days where you have to have a good relationship with your employees so that they like to come and work with you despite all the rain.
Thanks to 120 enthusiastic and skilled employees, Danfoss in Anshan made the project a success. Also, the spirit among colleagues by helping each other when help is needed, privately or at work, made the working environment a pleasant place to go every day.
Well, I think that's the beauty of the world as it's becoming small in that sense. It's very easy to work together across, and I think if we go to China, we also work with a lot of cities in China in different places, and some of those are as remote from Beijing as Sunderborg is from Brussels or whatever. So I think in reality, what a lot of those people, they want to see sincere projects, they want to see honest things that really work, they want to see the technology, and if it's coming from Sunderborg, I think that's all fine. It could be from anywhere as long as the substance is right.